Okay, it's my pleasure to introduce Lorenzo Bastonero from BTFL and Brennan University, where you are, who will talk, present his work on also based on AIDA and how to use it for rotational Thank you.
Thanks. Well, first, thanks to the organizer for having invited me to present you this work that I done with my supervisor, Nicola Marzari. So yes, indeed, I hope to show you, I mean, first, I'll say a traditional presentation where, I mean, I also show you why, the reason why we, let's say, chose to use AIDA for computing infrared and Raman spectra, and then I will also do a little demonstration if we will have some time left. So let me also introduce you really, really briefly to what are infrared and Raman spectroscopy for those that I mean maybe don't know. So basically, the idea is really that we have a source of light that can be indeed IR, or in the case for Raman, it's a laser source, so you have a monochromatic wavelength. And so basically you shine this light onto your sample that can be a molecule, a crystal, and then you detect the scattered light with a detector. And the idea is that indeed with this source of light you activate the vibrational modes that I think you also saw how to compute in the previous days. And this will be only for the gamma point, as you saw in the other days, just because the light doesn't have, let's say, momenta. So it's the moment that's really close to zero. And so, I mean, as a detection tool, the vibrational spectra can be really important, and they provide you with many advantages because they are really fast to measure in respect to other techniques. They provide you with an accurate description of the microstructure. They don't require sample preparation, for example, in respect to XRD experiments, and they're also suited for more complex systems that can have more difficult features to describe, especially because from the experimental point of view, the spectra can be really hard to disentangle or to really understand what features they describe. And here was, let's say, the amorphous silica that, let's say, 30 years ago wasn't really understood, these two peaks, D1 and D2. And thanks to the help of theory, I mean, as you can see here in this black continuous line, is the theory prediction. And even if it's not on top, of course, but at least it really provides you an idea of what features are really important for this kind of spectra also in amorphous systems. So the idea is that indeed, the guidance from theories are desirable for understanding the spectra and characterizing your sample. That can be really important in different fields, also in battery, for example. So now let's dive in a bit more into how we actually compute the spectra. And I mean, there is not only one type of Raman spectra, if you want. So here we really talk about first order non-resonant spectra. Non-resonant because you can also have the light that really excites also the electronic states. And so this is not the case that we treat here today because it's really, really complicated to account also for excited states because you can have excitonic effects or something else. So the caveat in this approximation that are actually well known is that, let's say, you only can use them for insulators. There are actually other techniques or other papers that use these approximations in more or less still in these approximations, but I mean, it's not always, it doesn't always work, let's say. So the idea is that for computing these quantities, so these are the Born-Effetti charges that you saw in the past days, and here is the Raman spectra, and the omegas are the phonon frequencies, the gamma, and this u is the eigenvector of the phonons. So the idea is that you can compute them basically with two approaches. One is perturbation theory, so the FPT I mean, density functional theory, also using finite differences. So I think you already saw in the past days this technique, and of course, I mean, they are really efficient and fast to converge, but also, as we discussed the last days, I mean, the implementation is really non-trivial, especially when you go for more complex functionals. And actually, finite differences provides, on the other hand, also to go beyond perturbation theory when you have to do ensemble averages. But of course, you're also limited by finite size, etc. So there are these two techniques. But actually, when I started my PhD, I had to compute the Raman spectra for the DFT plus U case. And there was no implementation in Quantum Espresso to compute these further order derivatives, which will actually give you the intensity of the peaks of the phonon walls. So actually here I just reported the plethora of method, and I mean, it's not exhaustive, but it's the one that are most used in the literature on how you can actually compute this further order derivative. So the most used actually still up today also in high throughput studies is this technique of the variational dielectric tensor. So the idea is that you compute the dielectric tensor with the FPT, and then you just displace the atoms and do the finite differences to get this tensor. And actually, it's a rather old technique we speak about 40 years ago, but still is still employed. And let's say that the advantage is that it is immediately available if you have the FPT implementation, of course. But the disadvantage is actually that if you, for example, go for amorphous system, it actually really scales badly with the number of atoms, like 6 times number of atoms. So if you have already a cell with not even 100 atoms, it really becomes super expensive. So the other idea was 20 years ago by Lazzari and Mauri to compute these further derivatives through this formulation upon the charge density. And actually, this was a very, very efficient and fast to converge in respect to K points I speak about. But still, the implementation is limited to the LDA approximation and to non-conservative pseudo potentials. The other one is still the 2R plus 1 theorem. So, as you heard also for perturbation theory, if you have the first order derivatives, you can also get the third one. But again, also here, the implementation is not straightforward. And the last one is that the one that I will speak about, that you can actually compute. If you look here, you can take just the first derivative in respect to atomic positions, and this is simply the forces. And then you can apply the electric fields to compute numerically the derivatives to get the Raman tensor. And also, this is kind of an old approach, but actually, there's a great advantage that we also explore later. Which especially it's quite easy to implement, and it's readily available for non-conserving and ultra-soft and PAW pseudo potentials. And also, as we will see, it's very easy to also get with other functions. So I immediately give you some hints on why also we really need to have more accurate functionals to really describe material. Of course, in the past days, you heard about DFT plus U plus V, and it's really giving huge improvements in terms also on the energetics. But also, we tried out, say, the code that I brought also to test the difference in the Raman spectra for these lithium-bearing batteries. And as you can see, the plain DFT is really not in agreement with the experiment. So it's not only giving you the right total energies, but also the vibrational properties are really off with, let's say, the standard GGA. While, as you can see here, with plus U and also plus U plus V, we really get more accurate results. There are still some discrepancies, but this can be also related to other issues with experiments, since these intensities for certain batteries can be really tricky to get accurately. And also some thermal effects can still be present, and we are here adjusting the harmonic approximation. So the other features can also come from there. So how would we actually then get these sensors from finite differences? Here, I just reported a really simple scheme. And actually, I wanted to show you that if we use the electric fields, actually we manage, let's say, really at the same time to get not only the Raman tensors, if we do the second order derivatives upon the forces, but actually, since we also computed the polarization, we get basically all these quantities in one shot, especially the Born-Fretti charges, the dielectric tensor, and also this tensor that is the non-linear optical susceptibility that can be really also an interesting property to compute for characterizing materials. And we are getting, with this approach, all these quantities in one shot. Here I reported, of course, that since we are doing these derivatives numerically, so we are, it's not, let's say, set consistent like in the FPT, we really also may make sure that we don't, our quantities are not affected by the step size. And so also in the code, I implemented the possibility of really adding more and more points so that the error that scales with the step size can be reduced as much as you want to. Of course, at the expense that you have to compute more steps, and that is more expensive, but at least we can make sure that our quantities are really accurate. So I also want to remind you, for those that I mean maybe don't know why this is so hard also to in solid states. And I take here just the simple example of the Born-Fretti charges when we really want to employ here the an homogeneous electric field in periodic boundary conditions. But actually, let's start from let's say 30 years ago, where still the polarization, I mean, you could compute the Born-Fretti charges by finite differences upon the polarization. So actually, in periodic boundary conditions, we still have that the position operator is undefined, as I think also was explained a couple of days ago. And also here, you can really see with this cartoon why this is also not working. So let's take this unit cell that describes this periodic system, one-dimensional, and let's say that the blue dot and the red dot are the negative and positive charge. So if we take this description of the unit cell, then the polarization described classically, let's say, points to the right. But as soon as we change the unit cell, still the system is the same, but the polarization points to the other direction. So 30 years ago, they were really wondering if still polarization makes sense in periodic boundary conditions. And actually, the answer from Vanderbilt, Smith, and Resta is that yes, it's still possible to describe these quantities via, although a more, let's say, elaborate formulation, which goes under the Berry phase formalism. And the polarization is no more a single valued function, but actually is defined upon modulo, a quantum of polarization that takes the shape. So it's still possible to compute, but as you can see, I mean, this implementation is a bit more tricky. But let's go on. So if we want actually to compute the further order derivatives, actually we saw that we really need to use a fine electric field. And here actually we have more problems, because we are actually putting in the Hamiltonian a coupling between the finite electric field and the polarization. Now can be described actually with the very faint formalism. But well, as you can see here, this functional is not bounded from below, because you can always lower down the energy as you want. So there is no global minimum. So this is really a problem, because you can wonder, I mean, how do you minimize this functional? Does it even exist a minima? And moreover, actually you're also breaking translational symmetry, because you're imposing with the electric field, you're breaking basically the periodic boundary condition. So also the block theorem in principle shouldn't work. So as you can see, I mean, it's not really trivial, but actually it turns out that you can actually use block states to describe some local minima. So as you can see here, you're actually imposing, let's say, a linear function. These are basically the periodic quantum states. And as you can see here, this is the generalized function. You can actually find local minima. So actually these local minima are metastable solutions that can actually be taken as metastable states, although these states exist only when a certain electric field is applied. So over a certain electric field, what happens is that you cannot find any more local states minima. And this is basically can be really simply understood that if you increase a lot of these electric field, of course, you are increasing the slope, and so this barrier that divides, that separates the local minima disappear, and so you cannot find anymore a local minima. So, well, it's tricky, but actually there is an implementation, it's working. So it provides this approach, actually, as I already mentioned, it allows you really to use any functional, because the generalized functional, it has only an extra piece that depends on the wave function, so you can really immediately use any functional. And it's also very easy to extend ultrasoft and PA-double pseudo potentials. As I showed you before, also the forces and polarization are computed on the same run. So you get four quantities in the same run. In principle, you can also go for higher order derivatives. It's really efficient in low symmetry systems, because you can imagine that you don't have to displace atoms. You really just need to place three or six different directions. And so it's really advantageous for these cases. And of course, we have, as always, limitations that I want to mention. For example, there is this trade-off with convergence due to this effect called Zener tunneling, where this critical electric field decreases upon the increase of the K-point sampling. So there is this, let's say, trade-off with convergence. Although, if you really don't have a very tricky system, usually you can always get converged results. It's a bit slower in respect to the FET implementation to converge with respect to K-points. And generally, as you saw, it's a bit cumbersome to do by hand, especially if you also want to if you also want to compute the phonons in the same run. So you really have now different pieces that has to go together. And so, as you can imagine, we wanted to solve at least the third part with AIDA. And also, I want just to mention here briefly how we are trying to, let's say, also here solve the slower conversion to K points. So starting for the second point, we are, in the code, we devise this directional sampling. It's actually a very old idea, because it's quite known that if you want to compute the polarization, you have to compute strings of K points in the direction of the polarization that you want to compute. So let's say here is the X direction. And so, of course, imagine that if you apply the electric field on the X direction, you imagine that the induced polarization will be in the X direction. So the simple idea is, okay, let's sample more the direction where we apply the electric field, and less, so the orthogonal direction, in respect to the applied electric field. So you can actually really, instead of increasing homogeneously the Mohr-Kruss path grid, you can simply increase on one direction the number of the K-points. As you can see, actually, this is something known, but we also tried it out automatically. As you can see, the directional sampling is really converging much faster than instead using a uniform sampling that scales, of course, much worse in respect to the total number of K-points. So here I'm showing you the total number of K-points that you have in the grid. And as you can see, we really gain some 3 times more less K points. So this is automatically done. Also here I show you the Raman tensor that actually converge faster. But for the Raman tensor, actually, since we are doing the final difference upon the forces usually converge quite fast also with K points. So all this machinery was implemented indeed in this package that we called AIDA Vibroscopy, where we really can exploit the features of automatization of AIDA. And the plugin is, of course, based on top of Quantum Espresso and PhonoPi, that provides some very nice features for performing phonons with final differences in supersets. And the idea was to simply provide the user with two main workflows. It is the phonon workflows that, generally speaking, just computes phonon frequencies and eigenvectors, all the properties that you want for phonons, and the electric workflow that actually exploit the theory that I just present you. And then, since we are speaking about infrared and Raman spectra, of course, we can join these two in the spectra workflow that automatically provide the user with infrared and Raman spectra. And as you can see here, it's also very easy to use, because we also devised, as you saw in the previous talk, this get build and from protocol method. So you can really get all the inputs for this complex workflow with just providing really the structure and basically the code where to run the simulations. So, I also want to go a bit more deeper in the description of the workflow so you can really understand how we managed to also improve the convergence and the speed up of the calculation. So taking the Phonon work chain, it's really simple. Actually, we start with a ground state calculation for the supercell, depending if you want also to do phonons. So this provides really the ground state charge density and the wave functions. And so basically, then afterwards, we can generate the supercell with the atomic displacements to compute the force constants. And we restart actually the SCF calculation from the charge density of the supercell ground state. This really is in the spirit also of perturbation theory, where you really can start from the ground state and then just perturb. The ground state with the atomic displacement. So restarting from the supercell charge density really improves also the convergence and the speed up of the calculations. And then automatically we gather together forces from supercell and we perform the derivatives to get the force constants. Then the dielectric work chain actually is more or less the same idea. It's just a little bit more complicated. So we start again from the ground state. Here we don't need supercells. We also evaluate with a non-self-consistent field, the band gap that allows us to evaluate this critical electric field. And so after we can evaluate this critical electric field, we determine the electric step perform and also the numerical accuracy that we want to achieve. Also, these are all customizable in the workflow. So if you want more accuracy, you can always ask for it. And then we determine all the directions of the electric field that are independent. So we also use symmetries to reduce the number of displacements, the electric displacement that we perform. And then we start from electric field zero. And then, if you have more than one step to perform for the electric field, we simply start from the first step. So it's a perturbation of the electric field equals zero. And then we increase again, starting from the previous run. So that always it's really a perturbation on top of a perturbation. And this really speeds up the calculations. And then finally, we gather together everything to compute the final quantities that we give in output. And also, I put some effort since you have force constants, structure information, tensors. The idea was also to gather together all this data in a unique data pipe. So in Python, you can access easily all these quantities, and it is really consistent. So you always know also the system reference that you are using, since, of course, as we know, we can always rotate crystals. So at least you are always consistent with the data. So here I just show you quite quickly some application that we did. We explored in these magnesium silicates different functional flavors to see if there was an improvement. And also, as was the initial idea, finally we also computed the empty ferromagnetic with DFP plus U with different flavors of the functional. Also here we really also explored in the paper we published on archive also let's say more complex functions such as hybrids, which are also quite expensive. We actually managed to compute the intensities, and also the package provide you also with nice interface to compute the single crystal Raman spectra, which are really useful to really detect particular features of the crystal. And finally, I also wanted to mention that this can really be coupled with other techniques. For example, you can really also insert here the line width of the phonons. For example, if you're interested in transport properties, you can also compare with experiments. As you can see here, we also shifted to really compare the line width, and we were really accurate in describing those. And also, since you also saw in the previous days the SHA theory, you can also compute the Raman ab initio. And since you need ensemble averages, this code is really probably it's very useful if you really want to run many configurations that also don't care about the symmetries because they're let's say, established. Approach where you just displace atoms and you compute the dielectric tensor in this case would be really, impossible to apply. I also want to briefly mention that we are also working, actually, we are basically finalizing also other workflows for actually computing the self-consistent Hubbard parameters, as you saw in the previous days. And I mean, the code will be published soon. And this actually goes with a really deep parallelization. So you really can parallelize over the Hubbard atoms and also the Q points. So you can really exploit maximally the computational time on the HPCs, since you can really parallelize with AIDA. And so here I just provide a quick summary. The codes are level one on GitHub. And before I finish, I really also wanted to show you really how this also works in practice, if I have the time. So you can really also, I think also in the GitHub repository of the school, there is a link to visit this. To visit this demonstration. This is really dedicated to the package I developed, and you can really explore it. And also you can use this binder to actually run by yourself if you don't want to install on your laptop. So here I just give you a really brief demonstration. Actually, here I just use Silicon, so it calculates fast the properties. I also put some effort to summarize a bit the theory I showed you, so you can also at home just rehearse it a bit or look it a bit more in depth. And here again, in the spirit of really getting, as you can see here, you can really simply get the structure from the COD database. This is usually very useful if you just want to, you know, go on the database and take it here. So you can really just use this piece of code to query it for it. And here it's just the ID of it. And then you can really immediately save it in your AIDA database. And again, here I show you that this, for example, is the dielectric word chain that I mentioned you before. So maybe we can just already run it, since it's taking, I think, 1 minute, but then, as you can see, it's started. And as you can see here, we really just exploited this get build and from protocol. So I really tried to encode all my experience I gained in these 2 years to really provide the user already with, you know, all the inputs that usually they need, so that they don't have to think too much and they really just tweak the parameters that you are really interested in. And of course, here we just went for the fast protocol, so we don't have to wait so much time. And as you can see, it's really running, performing different calculations. And probably it will take a bit more time, and as you can see, but we can just go a bit more down. So also here I reported, for example, the fourth order formula that actually will be employed in the workflow. So to compute the first order derivatives, I remind you that for effective charges and the electric tensor are just first order derivative of forces and polarization. And here actually we use a 4-point formula that actually scales as the step, the dielectric step to the power of 4. So we will actually have a very small numerical error for the finite steps. I think here it will be actually, yeah, this is now it's finished, as you saw. So we can actually just see the results. Actually, I mean, I ran it before. And here I just show you, really, since we, in this case, automatically, the code decided to go for a fourth order accuracy. Since you have 4 points, you can actually also compute the second order accuracy using just the outer points and the inner points. So you can also, in an automated fashion, already check whether your calculations are converging in respect to the finite size step. And as you can see, indeed, this is the case. So using either the external points or the inner points, the electric tensor components are basically converged in respect to this step. So you don't really need to go for the further accuracy. So you can just simply use 2 points. So this will be faster, for example. As you can see, it's really converged within numerical precision. And also here I reported the automatically chosen electric field step that in this case was 0.001. And also the finite electric field that was taken as to be 5 to the minus to the power of minus 4. And also here, as also was shown before, is let's say the provenance or the graph of all the steps that the work chain perform in automated fashion. So as you can see, it's not just a relaxation that probably is just simpler to do sometimes by hand, but in this case, really, we can see the advantage of using an automated workflow engine that really performs all these steps. So as you can see here, we really just did as an SCF, then a non-set consistent field. We evaluated the critical electric field, the accuracy, and the step. And then we started from electric field zero. Then we did a first step, delta E, and then a second step, two delta E, for the electric field. Since we have a lot of symmetries for silicon, we didn't need to also compute the negative values. So really here, the symmetries are really important to really reduce a lot the number of calculations. And simply here, I also show you that, I mean, the code is working properly. So also the Born effective charges are all zero, as you would expect, because in silicon, they're actually zero. But there is also another Jupyter notebook that uses aluminum arsenide. So you can actually see that these quantities are non-zero. And also here, again, I just show you again the convergence with respect to K points. And here instead, I just show you the vibrational spectra. I report again a little formulas, and basically, again, it's basically the same story. So again, we just query for a structure, we import it, and we simply call the I-Raman spectra work chain. And then you can just run it. I mean, as you can see, I ran it already before just to check that it was working. And I mean, it did all the steps. Maybe I just keep it so we can also go through the other. As you can see, it's quite complex since in the I-Raman spectra work chain, we also computed the phonons. And finally, indeed, as I mentioned before, we have this vibrational data. And as you can see, we again can check both the dielectric tensor and also the Raman tensors that are indeed these third order derivatives. And finally, I also provide you in the code, there are automated way to also plot immediately the spectra. Of course, for silicon, I mean, it's a bit boring, it's just one peak. And then also here we can really analyze the workflow taking all these steps. And as you can see, we really call the phonon work chain that just perform here first the ground state calculation. And indeed, the supercell with displacements in this case is simply one step because, again, it's a very symmetric system. And you can just explore it and again, really see also how it converges. And just to quickly finish it, I just also show you, for example, that you can also do band structure calculation with LAOTO splitting. This the web page that is linked in the school. So this is the harmonic work chain, since you can also compute the dielectric work chain in the same time. And as you can see, in automated fashion, we really also describe the phonon for aluminum arsenide with the correct LAOTO splitting, all with finite differences, so not the FPT implementation. And also here you can really see also the Born effective charges that are non-zero, and the dielectric tensor again. Here is also the nonlinear optical susceptibility tensor, which is reported in picometer per volt, and is actually a really interesting quantities that is usually not computed. And finally, also here some comparison with experiments. I mean, again, the results are not converged with respect to K points, but at least you can get a glance that actually we are doing some quite good job, especially for the Born effective charges. And again, as I also mentioned to you before, we really need to go for more K points if we want to converge the electric properties, such as the electric tensor and nonlinear optical susceptibility. And finally, again, there is an analysis of the workflow. And lastly, I will not run. I also reported here an example where we also compute the Raman spectra using the FT plus U plus V. There is an explanation and also the comparison with just the spectra using PbSol for lithium cobaltate. This is the PbSol spectra. And finally, you can define this Hubbard structure data where really we gather together the information for both Hubbard parameters and the structure. And finally, of course, we can compute the Raman spectra for FT plus U plus V and compare it to experiments. And the intensity seems indeed a bit more accurate for the FT plus U plus V, but again, I mean, here we didn't converge all the parameters, so I mean, it's a bit hard to say which one is better. And but at least you can really see that this is working for these functionals. And with this, I mean, there is also here some next steps, and I really also encourage you to publish your data if you will ever use this workflow is on Materials Cloud, because it's also really easy to export all the data to AIDA. You really just do AIDA export your data, and it already comes with all the provenance, all the steps, all the output inputs in really an automated fashion. And well, this is all for me, and thanks for all of you for your attention.
Thank you very much for that experience.
Yeah, it's the Konisham one. Yes. So I simply take the SCF at the SCF level, the band gap. I've never tried. I always experienced that at least with the little function describing with that and use the consham. Actually, I didn't need even to divide by or reduce the actual the critical value. I also noticed that it seems that you can really go a bit beyond that value. But yeah, I never tried to see whether it was lower or greater.
The thing is that you use a longer method to points along the region. Do you think it would be possible instead of using putting those points in a certain consistency, just compute the chart that this can be uniform symmetric point mesh, then we take the density to include the refactors on the other points after that step and just using those.
Actually, probably it wasn't clear, but yeah, actually in the code we start with an SCF. I mean, we determine all the possible grids when we do that ground state with just that grid, so with that grid for augmented k-points in that direction, then we start the electric fields at equal zero with that grid, so it's always a bit faster, and then we start also the final electric fields. What I think it's, I mean, it's a bit hard, indeed it's for finite electric fields, a bit hard since also the final charge density depends upon on the electric field value. So you will change since it's a non-linear equation also.
So you can apply the feed another query on parallel to the GVEC to the risk of the latency. What if you have two little feeds to get the cost then? So when you have the RJ.
Yeah, and actually there is also the implementation in Quantum Espresso that you can actually do also the mixers, and you will basically project
one of the you cannot apply identity in any direction.
No, you can actually apply it in any direction. And it will basically just project it to the lattice vector and compute it in those directions. So actually it's also how we thought how to improve the sampling. So you can really sample the reciprocal directions where it should be expected to have them all. Yeah, I also have here maybe a slide on that. I think it's here. So yeah, exactly. So we actually have to use this formula to reduce a bit the number of calculations. So we do, let's say this is the lambda, so the lambda is the mixed direction. And then we use still this formula to reduce the number of the calculation to do. And we still use the second order derivatives done in the single directions. So this way you reduce by actually six number of calculations to compute the mixed derivatives. So it is a nice approach if you're interested in all the components, but I mean, there would be also other formulation where you instead use the other cross direction to compute it. But since we're always interested in all of them, yeah, this is a formula devised in the paper of Mario 2003.
Thanks a lot, Lorenzo. Really nice work. So maybe I have just a few beginner questions, really out of curiosity. But at first, when you showed your Raman spectra and you compared against VB, did you pursue, and like you can see that you're even not on top of experiments, like there's a bit of a difference, and then you sort of alluded to other factors that might be at play. So do you have any perspective and questions? What is the role of the exchange collision functional? If in this case, under what perspective is important, and where is the limit of the theory itself that you're working with? So like, what would you do to sort of try to further improve the rule itself? And the second question would be regarding curiosity on the materials. And yeah, just because we know that this, because of the absence of electric screening and because you have that, your electric function always, you always go to one in the long way length limit. And whether this would, I mean, how does all of it, Raman spectra work for the materials and the influence on like how you sort of choose to, I mean, if there is any difference on the way that you put your
life. Yeah, no, very good questions. I mean, for the first one, well, it's sometimes it's, wait. Oh, well, I can also just show you these ones. It's the same. Just also the manganese one. Well, I mean, I think that one important thing, at least by experience, is really also really to understand how the experiment was performed, because sometimes it's really important to understand whether you really have a powder sample, if you have, for example, single crystals, or what were all the details really of the experiments, because they really can affect a lot. Also, for example, if you have a powder sample, in this case are all powders, for example, you can have not a perfect powder, so that can really, for example, favor some directions. And so the usual, you can do just averages in the powder spectra. So that can be also not applied perfectly. Or usually also, you know, from experience that, for example, temperature effects usually expand the unit cell. And this usually leads to softening the modes. So usually you have a shift on the left. But there's also, I mean, it really depends a lot on the material itself. You know, for example, lithium, you might also expect that really temperature effects can play a crucial role. So I think it's also really dependent on the materials, and again, really understanding how was performed the experiment, whether if this is just noise or it's really it's just an artifact or not. So that already really helps a lot in improving the agreement within those. And I mean, also from experience, usually GGA tends to, especially for oxygen, to underestimate sometimes the frequencies. especially at the in this range between 800 and 1000. So usually that's also something that comes, let's say, from experience, but as you can see here, it's not always, it's a case. But for the 2D materials, usually it applies because when you do Raman experiment on 2D, if I'm not mistaken, usually you, this is the direct, let's say this is the plane of the 2D, and this is the direction of the incoming light. Usually the polarization is of the light, so really the how where the electric field is oscillating is parallel to the material. So usually you not basically let's say sample this direction, the one orthogonal, where indeed you would have these effects of the screening that is not constant, for example. And also you should also use these other formulations, I think from Thibault, where they also put these other corrections, for example, the non-analytical corrections to the force constants is not the same as in 3D, or the work of Norma Rivano, where they indeed, for example, for 1D materials, you also have a circular, let's say, a cylindric symmetry also there. You also have to apply other non-analytical corrections, but also you really also can see that depending on the wavelength of your laser, you can also shift these frequencies. But regarding the intensities, yeah, indeed, usually for 2D is like that, and for 1D, I wouldn't know. I mean, probably you can also apply some other formulation if you can consider this. I should think about it more.
Other questions?
So what we need to support from this entire workflow is Polyvine.
Yes.
And and then your workflow starting with
it. Yes, exactly.
And then the
quantum espresso sound.
So in the following is in the intensity.
Yes.
But then we don't do explicit application when
we move that part of the point. No. No, that is indeed the other approach.
Yeah, but it's not what you do.
Exactly.
And then we do also put in the information about the following frequency and the following.
Yes. Exactly. So yeah, because indeed here, as you can see, there is this explicit dependency of the displacements, where here no. So this is a great advantage because you don't need to displace all the atoms, but you just need to apply the electric fields and the atoms stay there. So yes. In principle, you could, let's say, use the RAN for the phonons to also, let's say, compute the epsilon and then reconstruct back the Raman tensors in principle.
But that's only the unchanged. I mean, based on the Raman goals, you don't have the voice.
Yeah, it's the sort of thing. So you can identify what that the Raman active mode by seeing the effect.
I know that implementation, but I think that you can also just, basically detect the irreducible atoms and really just displace those as followed by us. You don't need to displace all of them. I mean, the Yeah, and then, indeed, as I probably also show you here, I mean, if you want to try it out, I mean, I also tried it with my MacBook. Incredibly, it worked out of the box. Also with all this Conda installation, so you can basically just install this other Conda, which is called Mamba. And I mean, it provides with the feature that it downloads. I mean, it's just faster also to detect all the dependencies, conflicts. I mean, also this is the really in the speed. I mean, this is kind of taken also from the work of Chris that just presented before. So I mean, it's really simple. You can also try by yourself. So you really git clone the actually the repository here of or also the one of Chris, which is here in Git on GitHub, and you just really just create an environment and then you activate it. And then you just run this Jupyter Lab, and it should basically work out immediately, giving you this. It should immediately open this page, and then you can really just, you know, go in tutorials, and then you can really just run it on your laptop directly. Because usually Binder is nice, but it's this online, thing where, I mean, usually it's very slow to compute because of course it's for free, but. If you want to try it out also on UPC, it should basically work out immediately. And then you can really, you know, also explore and change the inputs by yourself. So you can see it's interactive. So you can also play around with it and, I mean, see if it fulfills your needs. And
another point, sorry. This is what I did with the use of one test. At some point, you see that if I remember correctly, there's no parallelization of the key points that you need to add this on the same page. So this still in there, so there's no parallelization of the key points.
No, that's a bit a tricky point because indeed, I mean, it's also in practice, even, I mean, in principle, you can also parallelize over K points.
Yes.
But then you would have so much communication between nodes that eventually it's not convenient. What can be done, I think, that really can speed up is also implementing symmetries because, you know, you can have strings of K points. So let's say in this example, you can really have strings that are symmetrically connected. If you see what I mean, where was it? I think. So you can really, for example, say, okay, this string is symmetrically connected with this one, and so you really remove lots of K points immediately. So that can think that's something that can be implemented to really speed up a lot because you already remove lots of strings. And another idea is that, for example, for mixed directions, where you, I mean, let's say that this is the electric field directory. I mean, in principle, it would be very much nicer if you can rotate also the Brillouin zone. I mean, the K-point sampling to go in that direction and reduce. While still here, we are employing a simple Moncourt's path grid. So we are just increasing the direction here and here. But yeah, I mean, it's not so easy. And yeah, but the problem is that when you apply the electric field, it's a self-consistent cycle, so it's... the advice would be just if you have a smaller node, just run that node for longer if you can. So that's how usually I do it. Also, interestingly enough, from my tests, usually you don't really need the superconverged tensors by themselves. Usually the intensities converge faster. And sometimes really what also in experiments matter more is not really having the absolute intensities. You really just want to have an idea of what this peak is, or if you have more of one peak, not really, I mean, it's not so important if it's really like one more intense or the other one. So you can also not really go for extreme convergence. And this also, the routine is actually fast in that case. And again, also here, you can exploit the fact that since AIDA is parallelizing all this calculation, you can send all the calculation in different nodes and run it quite fast. So that's good. Thank you.
I have a curiosity. In one of your last slides, you showed a comparison between the FP and the classical spectrum. I was surprised to find the extra peaks in one of the two elements. Which one?
In this one?
No, one of the last. I mean, in that one, you were
in here.
A quantitative difference, but
yeah,
more or less the same features.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they moved the peaks, but no. One of the last slides that you showed, probably the work in progress or something.
Maybe one of the.
Ah, yeah, probably.
Just meeting the need.
Yeah.
I was here. This one?
Yeah, this one. How come that you don't get it second?
No, actually, he's here. It's a bit more. It's just super small. Yeah, it's there.
What is that second?
This one here?
The two. So that's the experiment?
Yeah, this is the experimental value. This is plus U plus B. This is PB solved. No, but actually, it is the.
I haven't seen the.
It's quite small. I think we are maybe in the in this one you can see it a bit better, but yeah, not really. While actually in experiment you have still this other peak, but probably it will be an harmonic peak or second or the future. I mean, I really don't know. I mean, it's just a guess.
Yeah, curiosity. What would you need to do to extend it to resonance?
Yeah, the point is that you. I mean, this approach is very nice because you can do infrared Raman, but it's just for non-resonant case. Since they apply the electric field, I mean, you can't get really excited states from this approach. I think, I mean, actually, Yuri just sent me also, I mean, there is another package that still exploits in Quantum Espresso to actually do the resonant case. So you need, instead, it's not for all the functions, of course, because it's more complicated, but you can use, for example, because you can also rewrite all the cross sections with the electron phonon couplings. So you, that you can compute with the FPT. In principle, you can also compute the electron phonon coupling by finite differences, but that would need, I think there are some efforts now also in the Nicolas group to compute those. And then once you have them, you can really just do the brackets. But also there you are missing something in the sense that there is approximation. It's still a resonant. Like you, for example, missing the excitonic effects. So it depends a bit always what you want to do. I also know there are another effort for, I think it was called non-diabolic exciton phonon coupling Raman spectra. But it was very interesting approach where you use YAMBO to also compute the excited states of electrons. Mm-hmm. And then you basically put together everything. But again, I think they just did it for LDA and so I mean, it's always a balance of what you actually need in that moment. But here it's very important because, I mean, I think here the nice thing is that you can, for example, in batteries where you also have magnetic structures, here it's all, I mean, it's working quite well out of the box. While if indeed one wants to go for the resonant case, which also it's kind of tricky because depending on the end gap, also you're exciting, since it's in a resonant, also the spectra will depend on the band gap, so you have really to make lots of things right at the same time. It's not super easy. But I mean, yeah, it can be done for sure. Fortunately, there are also the other packages that not necessarily use either for this case. I mean, less automatized, but still can be done.
Other questions? Okay, no, let's thank the administration.